Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the March board meeting of the Woodstock Library Board. Roll call, Dorothea Marcus is here. Barry Miller?
Here.
Selma Kaplan?
Here.
Kevin Kraft?
Here.
Tammy Katsowitz?
Here.
Carolyn Jerome?
Here.
Jill Fisher?
Here.
David Lewis is excused absent, a last minute victim of the flu. Bobby Bowie?
Here.
Jesse Jones?
Here.
Liz Rosen?
Here.
Okay, so all but one person. Do I have a movement? Someone's phone is.
She's not going to stop.
Is it your computer?
Is it?
Excuse me.
No, I know, but I can't. I don't know what's going on with my screen.
Can't you turn the volume off?
Can't unplug it.
Oh, I know what it is.
What's your book on tape?
Oh, it's my daughter's book on tape.
Okay.
I'm so sorry.
Thank you, Carolyn. Okay. Does anyone move that we adopt the agenda for tonight?
I make a motion that we adopt the agenda tonight.
Okay. Any seconds?
I second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Oh, one, we're making a change. We're going to have the policy committee report go first, if that's okay with everyone?
What is that?
The policy committee report will go first.
Okay.
Okay. All right, adoption of the minutes from February 21st.
Don't tell me.
I never got a copy of it.
I've never got a copy of the minutes.
I don't know.
The minutes might sound.
They were, yes.
They were in the email yesterday.
They weren't in the folder, and I just.
Well, we need to table, should we, in interest of time, if people didn't review them, let's table that to the April board meeting. Okay. Now, before the public be heard, I'd like to read a statement from the president. That we are aware that a number of you may be here to comment on the contract for architectural services with Stephen Tilley. We want you to know that contract negotiations are still underway and no vote on a contract will be taken tonight. The distribution of an early draft by community members was premature. Once we have final contract language negotiated, it will be posted on the library's website and notice will be provided to the Woodstock Times so that the community has a chance to review it and comment on it prior to its adoption. The library board continues to be open and transparent in all its dealings. There also was a community member who suggested to a trustee that he resign from the board before we sign the contract so that no trustee should be liable for the full amount of the contract if we don't raise the money, and we have been advised by our attorney that that is not true at all. The trustees would not be personally liable. So now we will go to public be heard, and we will be timing. We have a lot of people here tonight and a full agenda. And also, please, no personal attacks on any trustees or staff members or community members. That will not be tolerated. Thank you. Okay, can yes. Selma could read it because she's the one who's going to write down who's first.
Mr. Bob Lavaggi.
Hi, Bob.
How are you?
Good evening. I'm going to stand there so everybody can hear me.
Okay, great. Thank you.
He's not going to be on the camera, so.
Well, he'll be heard then.
Okay, can everybody hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
But I can't see you.
Good.
Okay.
I've never broken the ice at an occasion like this, but I hope I set a good, optimistic course for the rest of the evening. When the election was done in November, I concluded that we were going to have a $5 million library. And just accepted that as the result of that vote. And I congratulate all of you for sustaining in that vote. Recognize that you're the authority, and I'm speaking to each of you board members this evening. Now it's been going on 4 months, since the election, and I was waiting to see a bond for the $5 million. And then, Kevin told me it's not a done deed yet. We still need to float the bond. And I got to thinking that it's possible that you're not floating the bond because you're not confident they can get $5 million. And that would be consistent with my, with all the conversations that I've had with the people I know around town. They're not happy about $5 million bond. And I would like this process to move forward, and so I made a suggestion to you that I wrote to you, so I would not take time talking about it now.
I think we haven't seen it yet, because we just got it tonight.
You all have it.
Yeah.
It's you all received the envelope that I mailed to each of you. Right now, you need assets. Your main asset are the residents of Woodstock who will step up and own the bond that you are going to float. They are your asset. That's where your funds are going to come from. And you need to be confident before you go to them that they're going to give you the funds. My instinct is that what I'm proposing would get widespread support from the community. Okay. Another asset that you have...
We'll give a wrap-up minute to everyone.
Did I get my wrap-up minute?
No, you're going to get a wrap-up minute.
Okay. One of the assets you have is 3,000 feet of library space, which would cost you $1.2 million to replace. To tear it down and rebuild it, $1.2 million. You have that asset in your pocket. I inspected that building this week and looked at all the things that were brought to my attention as problems. The water in the cellar can be remedied without a lot of money. There's a beam that's crushing down in that far room there. It needs a pillar right down to the foundation, going right up to the girder. Just so happens that that pillar would come right in the middle of a door. We'll just move the door, put the pillar there, and that sound. The bluestone foundation around the buildings is sound, and the bones of that building are sound. So you have an asset there, and I'm suggesting to you that you don't tear it down, that you use it. The front...
Yeah, the time is up now.
Time is up?
Yeah, you've had an extra minute already.
Oh, thank you for the extra minute. Does anyone have a minute that they can give me from their time?
Could I give him my minutes?
Sure.
Okay. I'd like to give him my minute. I'll cross my name off the list.
The front room, the large room of the library. It's a beautiful room. It can be the children's room with French doors. Kevin, French doors in the main room. That room. Opening out onto the garden so that children can go in and out freely and have the celebration that you wish they have. And the door to the library should be here from Library Lane so that when people walk in, the children's room is there, the desk is here, and there's 4,500 square feet of library, which is 1.5 times the size of the town hall. I urge you to give this serious consideration, and if you go with it, you will have wind in your sails, and you will have a library. Rather than squeezing and twisting and squirming to get every inch that you can get from every place. You do have a parking limitation of 50 cars if you build a 10,000 square foot library. Just accept it.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bob.
Thank you, Bob.
Thanks very much. And we all have a copy of your full statement. Okay, who's next on the list?
Me.
I don't think we'll listen anymore.
It really actually works better if you can handle it later.
Yeah. Because we won't be seen on the video. You can face the audience.
How can you tell me shame on me when I express my heart? You tell me shame on me? Yeah. Well, shame on you for telling me shame on me. Yeah. I don't accept that. Okay. I don't accept it. No. I don't accept it. Okay. I do not accept it. Go ahead, tell me again. Shame on me.
Hey,
I don't accept it. Shame on me.
Les and Bob, please.
Come on. By the way, he's right.
Please, no comments.
When is anybody in this place come off shaming somebody?
I do not
accept that shame.
Okay, I
express my heart in good faith.
We appreciate it, Bob. We appreciate it. Leslie, please, no comments from the audience. Personal comments to anyone. Please. Okay, and what's your name, please?
Let's take a moment.
Yeah.
So I think that all can see.
Let's just take a moment.
Yeah, I agree.
We need to let people speak their hearts, really.
Yes. And yelling is not acceptable. It's just not acceptable. Not by anybody in the room.
Or name calling. We really need to demand a level of respect amongst our community members here. And if we cannot maintain that, I will not continue this meeting. But it will not happen.
I agree.
Many members feel disrespected by what the library board does.
Okay, no, okay. Excuse me, you're out of order. You can sign up for public be heard.
May I ask the name of the woman who's about to speak, please?
Okay. My name is Toni Wiedenbacher. I have lived here all my life. Well, the biggest part of my summers was coming to the library fair, and I considered myself part of the library up until 2 years ago when he was told not to come back. My son, who is basically single-handedly held together the volunteer ambulance squad, was delighted to bring the ambulance here, both to showcase it and also to give you the protection that virtually every other library fair also has by having an ambulance there. But they were told that the space could be rented for money so that they didn't need them anymore. I really feel hurt about that because I know that Teddy has practically given his heart to hold that ambulance together. And the publicity that having the ambulance here toward the town was a way of showing from the library's point of view how much they cared for the town and for a volunteer ambulance squad in which people working him about 60 hours a week volunteer are giving their hearts to save people's lives. Okay, be that as it may. Also, I would like to congratulate Bob Lavaggi on his gentle touch. That what he wrote and what he did took a tremendous amount of research. We all need to work as a team. Otherwise, there is no anything. And even if it is, people won't come to see it and they won't be here. I mean, I personally have not been in the library except one time since my son was kicked out after a couple of years ago when they just told me he didn't need you. Unemployed. I do feel that the last election was a farce. And I'm saying this because it should have been done in a way that people understood what they were voting for. I heard people saying, well, if you vote yes, you save the library. If you vote no, you save the library. I like the library. I'm saving it. And it's nice that either way it's saved. Oops. That was not the way it was redundant. It should have said, if you vote one way, yes or no makes it awkward because people picture yes and no in a different way. But if you vote plan A, you get one thing. If you vote plan B, you get another thing. And then people would know exactly. And by making it look like vote yes, save the library, it almost made it look like perhaps you didn't think that people would vote yes if they knew that what the first thing was supposed to be was demolish the library. And I think that if we're going to work as a team, we have to be transparent. We have to say what's really on our mind. Now, I thought that what Bob came up with was a very important thing. He was saying, let's save what we have and love what we have, and then add to it what we may also need. Let's not just throw out the baby with the bathwater and then start over again. So what I'm saying is, I agree with Bob. I didn't come here together with him. He was here. I was here way before because I was putting some bags together for bread that I have to give away. I work with family, and we do a thing in facilities, too. But anyway, I think that his idea is very valid. You want more space. We also are a small town. How much space do we need? How much money do we really have? But let's keep what we have and build on, rather than just throw it away and start over. And if this architect can't do it, this town is full of builders. Good builders, honest builders. Why don't we go local and use what talent we have, who also know the town? And by golly, this is a town to get any consensus of. We haven't even gotten a light, and they've been fighting about that for at least 70 years. Being 77 myself, I remember the fights when I was 7. And we still don't have a traffic light. And by golly, they have to hire people to stand there to direct traffic. So whatever it is, we're going to have to start slow, but we don't start by saying, this is what we're doing, and pay up. That gets a little expensive. Well, you have to start, even though it may take another few years. What do we really want? What do we really need? What can we really afford? And all that. I think I've used my time.
Yes.
I appreciate your time, but also my friend Bob, who I know is not used to public speaking, and was a little bit nonplussed to be put at first. He gave his heart and lots of time. He needs your respect.
Thank you, Tony. By the way, because of the importance of public, we extended the time limit to 4 minutes for people. That's why it may have seemed a little longer. You don't have to use 4 minutes, but you have 4 minutes. Because we don't like to have people off.
I'm not sure, I can't read it. Rose? What's your last name?
Jambra.
How do you spell?
J-A-M-B-R-O-N-E.
Thank you, Rose.
I didn't know I was going to come into a meeting this charged.
We didn't either.
So I just want to say that I've been following this for years, and we all could say that we have a cohort of people that we've talked to that believe in one way or another. And mine is what I feel like is the silent majority that really supports the library and wants the new building and never comes to meetings and never writes letters. And I include myself in that. I'm realizing now that I should have spoken out a long time ago. So I'm not really here to say anything more about the building. I just want to, which I do believe we should build and that we can get everyone to pay for. I just want to say that I'm very distressed by the implications that the board is deceptive, sneaky, manipulative, blah, blah, blah. I think that that's very damaging to the ability to get anything done. And if there have been missteps here, I think some of it comes to do with the fact that you're always feeling you're facing a hostile group. I knocked on the door to come in, and somebody let me in looking very nervous tonight. And I thought, what kind of a response is the board getting that it should be in that position? So that's what all for me.
Thank you, Miss.
Thank you
very much. Who's next?
I've heard the number $5 million used. And I've heard that number described as a cap. And so I want to talk a little about some of the things that are not included in that cap. And I'm going to ask you, please, over time, not tonight, but over time, to provide the numbers so that everyone can know what the total cost of your project is. Architects Basic Services, we've seen that written, $584,000. Supplemental Services, if you look in the contract, you can see. And by the way, I did not give the contract to anyone, Dorothy. I don't know if you think someone did, but you mentioned that earlier.
Someone circulated it.
I didn't. Third is Construction Manager Agent. I've heard the $135 an hour. Given for that, that's $22,000 a month, that's $260,000 a year. That's a substantial cost, and that should be listed, that should be conveyed to the public. Financing, on $2 million, financing over 30 years is over $1 million. It depends on the interest rate, of course, but that's a significant cost that should be listed. The attorney, should be listed. I don't know what that is, but you can give us a number on that. Demolition and disposal of the library buildings. That should be estimated or budgeted, and we should know what that number is. Temporary library, while 5 Library Lane is closed. You should talk about that, I believe. Furnishings and fittings. That's going to be a substantial cost, and you should provide a budget for that or a cap or give us a number on that. Telecommunications equipment design, purchase, and installation. That's going to be significant. And I have a footnote there on 3 items here that that's something that you would have to collaborate with the architect on. If there are wires going in the walls, that has to be planned in advance. Information technology equipment design, purchase, and installation. That's going to be significant. The security system, landscaping, parking and walkway construction, and I'm sure there are others. All of these things, I believe you need to come up with a number and let people know what your plan is for the cost for this project. Thank you.
Thank you, John.
Thank you.
Who's next?
Next is Gay Lambert.
Gay?
Okay. Yes. Appreciative that you started with.
Can you speak up a little?
Yeah. I was appreciative that you started with saying that the there's going to be no vote on the contract with Tilly now. I'm wondering, I have a bunch of questions that all fit together. Is there a new schedule to proceed with Tilly?
No, or is that not? We decided we're not going to be responding in the middle of the public be here.
The reason I'm asking is because what I wanted to say has questions in it.
You can ask the questions and we can get back to you after the meeting.
Yeah. So I was happy to go to the presentation that Rebecca Aldridge did, and one of my questions was, are you planning on taking her advice, you know, given her long experience, to plan a campaign that was either bond referendum focused or private fundraising focus. And to that end, my follow-up questions were, you know, how much money does the library now have in its capital fund and its improvement fund? And you can see how all those questions fit together.
Some of these issues will be discussed later tonight in the meeting.
Okay,
we will be discussing fundraising strategies.
I would love to hear if there's going to be a conversation about whether you're going to follow up on Rebecca's advice.
Yes.
Yes, that's
yes,
the conversation.
That's the conversation. Thank you. Okay, who's up?
Let's see. Tim Moore.
Evening. John, thanks for this. I really want the town to be on the same page in terms of numbers, and I think that the board is going to be very conscientious about making sure that all the numbers are before the people. The one thing I wanted to do was to again express my confidence in this board and in the board process in general, to make sure that every step of this process is transparent. I know they will be. I want to encourage anybody who has some some questions or some objections to what the board decides, to make sure that you don't turn that into trying to tainting the board either as incompetent or as somehow exercising some kind of malfeasance. They are doing their best to be as transparent as possible here, to give everybody a chance to speak, and I want to encourage you to all to come and participate every month and to keep an eye on the actual facts of the matter. Every once in a while, a letter will appear in the Woodstock Times that doesn't really, that distorts the facts or runs with a presumption. There was a letter from Carol Anderson this week that made some assumptions about the commitments that are made to the architect. That is still being negotiated, so anybody who did distribute that contract that was that the board got a preview of has really been doing a disservice to this process. It was a contract that was still under negotiation and won't be signed because there's a clock that needs to, that's going to be starting to tick as soon as that contract is signed. So there are a number of ducks to get in a row on this process, and I hope that everybody will be patient with the board and pay attention to all the actual facts as they unfold here. Thanks.
Thank you, Tim. Janice? No, I think that's...
I can't read it.
It's Zabo, Julie Zabo.
Oh,
Julie
Zabo. Oh, sorry.
Sorry. I can read anything.
S-Z-A-B-O?
Yeah, S-Z-A-B-O. My name is Julie Zabo. I'm a 16-year resident of Woodstock and a great fan of libraries in general and books in particular. And I'm here today because I first started attending the meetings pretty regularly after the vote. And I voted, as I explained to the board at the time, I voted yes in order to dissolve the board. And I didn't do this with any... it wasn't an emotional or a quick decision. I did it because I voted yes because I absolutely don't want to tear the library down. I like the old library. There's a lot of reasons for that. And I felt that the current board wasn't being responsive to a more inclusive process or the possibility of a creative compromise. And I came to the meetings. And I learned a lot of things at the meetings, including that I understand that the work that the board did, the way they reached the decision to opt for a new building. But what I don't see, and I still don't see, is that that vote that happened at that time, the yes versus no vote, was not a vote to tear down the building. It was just a vote to keep this board in place. And at that point, the board had, and still has, an opportunity that I urge deeply from my heart of hearts, is to create a process for a better library that's more inclusive and allows citizens, like Bob here, to come here with their ideas and be that's part of the structure of the building. And now the reason I'm arguing for this is that we're living in a very uncivil time where there is no possibility of discourse. There's hate on one side, there's neoliberal superiority on the other. And I don't know what the process of, but some of the things that were discussed that I don't really know what happened is that, for instance, the board, I feel very strongly the board election process should be more democratic, and we talked about that should be switched to so that there's a vote. And I think the issues that are happening here should be clearly put up for a vote, and that the town, the board members should campaign so there doesn't have to be a committee who convinces or educates the public into your idea, that rather it should be a thing where there's a campaign, people campaign who are pro-new library, anti-new library, everybody gets to say what they want, see what they want, and somehow there's a process in voting yes or no. Now, I just want to say also my reasons for why I think the teardown is a bad idea. And this is after having looked at the documents that the professional library evaluator came and, you know, said why this library, is not so great. But this is what my idea is. Financial, first. This $5 million price tag, even if you do manage to fundraise all of it, is a problem. And let me tell you why. One is that if the fundraising, first of all, if it's going to be a fundraising like the other librarian did, Jessica Aldridge, who presented this way of creating a capital campaign, the only reason that squeaked by and didn't get a lot of votes was because there was a clear vision of what the community wanted. That's not what we have. We have an idea of what the library board wants, and there are people in the community that supports that, but there is not a comprehensive and inclusive idea of this is our vision for the library. And that's missing. And I think that a capital campaign won't work. So even that $5 million is sort of a pipe dream, like that you can raise it, unless the vision is clear. So how do you create a clear vision? That's one question I would ask the board. And that is key in order to create this better library that everybody wants. The second thing, one thing that really disturbed me in this whole thing is that in terms of financial thing, you're not paying a living wage to some of your staff. And so it's a priority question. You're paying $12 or less to some of the staff, and you're going to be raising $5 million for a new library.
Julie, I just need to correct, and we're not, answering questions.
The last thing, so I'll just skip the whole financial thing, I made my main point with the capital campaign, that there are people, we are living in an economy, a country that's been devastated by income disparities and the 1% versus the no percent. And we have a microcosm of that in our community with inflated real estate prices and old people who've moved here a long time ago who cannot take any more taxes on. They can barely live here as it is, and they're being pushed out. So that's that. Now, I'm going to skip the environmental reason, and I'm going to go to the historic aesthetic reason of why. No, the thing is, there's no room for this. You know, I've come to many meetings.
Julie,
and the
don't.
But so I'll stop. But I'm just saying that somewhere there has to be room for this conversation. That's it.
Thank you. And you could submit further comments in writing to us.
Oh, I will.
You know, we have 4 minutes for each speaker.
Yeah, we have to be.
That's how we're trying to accommodate everyone.
People have come here and asked to change the process of how people are being heard.
And we are.
I'm sharing the meeting.
It has not happened.
Thank you. Okay, who's next?
Sam
Magarelli. We have quite a bit of board business still to do, too. Sam.
Hi, everybody. I think it's fair to say that the majority of people in this community want this library to succeed, to see a better library.
Can't hear you.
I think it's fair to say that the majority of people in this town want to see a better library. They want the library to succeed. There's been well over a decade of all this storm and strain, and it's divided the community. But what's wonderful is, what do we do now? How do we move forward? And I know you're all, have your best interests of the community at heart, and many people understand that. But unfortunately, what you want is a library that the community, a proposal that the library would, that the community would embrace. Rather than, you want to appeal to about 70-80% of the community. Right now, given the survey and the various things that have happened, it doesn't look like you have the majority of the people behind you. And it would be a shame if you proceeded without that support. I think as a legislative body or as a body that has the ability to make decisions on behalf of the community, it would be, I think, unethical to proceed with a minority support. So take steps to give the community a chance to not just give you individual anecdotal feedback, but do a vote, get your project in order, put it to a vote, give the community a chance to make decisions. I think if you proceed with what it seems like, committing a large amount of community resources, well over $500,000, without the community support, that would be just one more step backwards. So as with all my heart, and I believe I know a lot of people feel the same way. Make the right choice. Try not to force fit a mega library idea in this place. There are well over a few thousand people who would love to vote to support improving this library, making it better, making it bigger. And so it's up to you. Good luck.
Thank you, Sam.
I apologize to each of you for expressing my anger.
Yeah. I wasn't
totally. Don't worry.
Thank you.
I didn't expect to express anger here tonight.
Got it.
Thank you.
Is there someone else?
That's it.
Okay. Oh wait, she. Her name.
Oh, yes. I'm Janice Stacks.
Yeah.
Oh.
Oh, that was.
Oh, that is.
Oh. Yes.
Sorry, we missed.
Oh, I heard Janice and
so
that's okay. No. So I just want to say.
Can you say your name, please? So,
yes, I'm Janice Staggs. So I just want to say at the outset, Janice Staggs.
Could you
Janice like Joplin.
Got that.
Staggs, S-T-A-G-G-S.
Thank you.
Okay. So my husband and I are relative newcomers to the town. We haven't been part of this whole process. We're huge fans of the library and have been very interested to be part of the process, to participate in the survey, to hear the presentations at the community center. We were thrilled with the selection and very excited to see what the board and the community will decide together with bringing a wonderful, great 21st century library to the town of Woodstock, which it clearly deserves. This is one of the proud, crowning achievements of our community. So really my question today is really one that's informational as a newcomer. I just would like to understand the process and also the fiduciary responsibilities as a taxpayer in Woodstock. I was, you know, curious and thrilled that the architect that I personally favored was the one that was chosen, and wondered then what would happen next. Would there be a bond floated? Would there be a capital campaign? I figured we'd hear about it from the town, through the newspaper. As has been pointed out, there have been a lot of legitimate news stories as well as letters coming into the editor that have had different kinds of information. It's hard to suss through that what's true and what's innuendo and what's actually just false. So I am here tonight just hoping for more information and to better understand when there are questions, how we can get that information, and how it will work. Because one of the innuendo letters that was in the paper last week mentioned that once the contract is signed, the town is on the board, the taxpayers are on the hook for the $500,000. And so I questioned, that doesn't really seem like that would be how it would work. So that's why I just wanted to ask the question. How will it work once the contract is signed, once there's a commitment to move forward so the architect can come up with the plans that we would know what it would truly cost, and that you can also get the information that John Ludwig has, you know, I think appropriately asked for all the other accessories and things that are needed. And some time ago, someone else also raised the question of, you know, assuming we can raise the money, we can move forward with this great new building, then what's the ongoing maintenance cost, insurance cost, etc.? So I think those are the sort of things I would like to understand so I can be responsible and know how to plan, and we can all move forward together with this bold vision and can feel like we can move forward in it, move forward to this future in a way that we can all be accountable for our responsibilities. So that's really all that I'm asking this evening, and I look forward to hearing more.
Thank you, Janice. Is there anyone else who's come in late or who's been inspired or motivated by any comments made that would also like to participate in public be heard before we go to board business? Okay. Speak now or forever hold your peace.
And a lot of these questions will be answered.
Yes, a lot of this will be
meeting.
Right. We will be discussing the capital campaign in detail.
I guess I would like to say.
What's your name, please?
Elaine Henke, H-E-N-C-K-E. Wesley Gerber wrote a letter to the paper saying that you had benefactors who would cover a lot of the costs. But that's like the rich get to decide what happens to our town. I don't see how that is really democratic or helpful.
Thank you.
Good. Thanks. Okay, anyone else? Okay. All right, thank you, everyone. Thank you very much. It was very helpful for us, our discussion tonight. Okay, we now have financial reports.
Yep.
And we will start with a checkbook voucher report.
Sure.
Or it needs to be in the center room.
Yeah, really have an extra copy. Oh, here's one. If people leave before we have the conversations of the questions that they were asking, they won't get the answers. I just want to say that out loud.
What?
Because many questions were raised by some of the people who are now leaving the room, and they've said what they had to say, but I was hoping that they would stay and hear what we had to say so that they will get the facts that they were looking for. That's all.
I was hoping that too. Yeah, definitely. Well, I do want to say if anyone needs to leave early, I mean, because we are going to have an extensive fundraising conversation tonight.
And we'd encourage you, if you have to leave, to look at the videos.
That's what I was going to say.
Everything's going to be on there.
There will be a video on our website, on the library YouTube channel, of the entire board meeting. And Nick Henderson from the Woodstock Times is here, and he does a pretty objective and fair job of covering our discussions at these meetings. So you have two sources if you have to leave early.
So your answers will be on the video?
Well, not necessarily answers to every question, but we're going to be discussing our you know, capital fundraising versus, you know, private fundraising versus bonding, and what our next steps are to have a timeline and strategy. Yes.
Could you just tell people they can send their questions in full?
To communityfeedback@woodstock.org. Wait, to communityfeedback@woodstock.org, or you can email me at marcus@woodstock.org.
All of the trustees' emails are on About Us page at woodstock.org.
Yes, you can also contact Jessica, too, for information.
Yes.
Okay.
However, spending.
And I'm sorry, we do have to go, you know, legally we're obliged to do our financial reports and the director report. Okay.
Checks and vouchers. February 7th through March 13th. some odd things. There's a check for RCLS, which was for Music Growth Advocacy Day. Program letters. Payne and Lakakis is our board retreat facilitator. LS maintenance and lawn care is the snow removal. I think it was about normal. Usually we spend about $700 on snow removal.
This was just 1 month, right?
This was 1 month, yes.
A few snowstorms.
Yes. Yep. Roger's been doing quite a few things. There's a few on the second page, advanced micro imaging, which is some storage of our archival materials, Advantage Archives. On the next page, the 1900 was digitizing the Woodstock Times. We've now digitized the Woodstock Times from 72 when it started to 1991. You can get to it on our website.
Well, that's great.
Yeah. There is a charge for Canopy with a K. That is a streaming movie service. You can get streaming movies from the library.
I've been told that if you have a Roku, that you can sync it to your Roku and watch it on your Roku.
Yeah. And
they have apparently a great library of movies.
They do.
You know, documentaries, foreign films.
On the almost last page, there's another charge for Mount Vernon Fire Insurance. We paid
the beginning of the contract, or the year statement, and then we just paid the end of it at the last time the bookkeeper was here. It's easier to get. It's all of the library's insurance for the building, for the liability, for everything. On that page, there's a charge for SCOLA, which is streaming foreign news, and that'll be appearing on the website really shortly.
You mean like from other countries?
Yeah, foreign.
And that 300 is for the entire year?
Yes.
In their languages?
Yes, okay. Yes. Wanting to provide a few more foreign language options. Sunny Lurk is the Southeastern New York Library Resource Council. One of our staff members is going to a training. Chopin Electric was here and did some repairs to the light in the front of the building. He's going to come back on Monday morning and install an additional electrical circuit so I can add some more computers without exploding things. And then the WOW dry carpet cleaning at the bottom is our cleaning service, not just carpets, but we've been cleaning carpets. What else? The questions on these?
Yeah, well, I think we can try to expedite.
Sure.
Okay. People don't have questions. I move that we approve voucher.
The numbers are out of order.
Yes, I noticed that.
17066.
Oh yes. Okay.
Through 17117.
Okay. Great. Thank you.
You're welcome.
And can we please have the numbers in order?
Yes,
this month?
I will.
It's very confusing. Okay.
I second.
Okay.
Motion.
Okay. Oh, do we all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The motion passes. Needs to go to budget versus actual.
If you look at the budget versus actual, we've got the tax check this month. So the $585,544 is in the bank. We are getting a payment from the Friends on the programming that they supported. That'll be appearing on the next year's month statement. Otherwise, we're pretty much in line on salaries. At benefits, we are in line on the print materials. The periodicals, we do one or a large payment to W.T. Cox for the whole year. That's already done, but for the whole year. Materials and programming are normal. The Friends donation will be covering the program spending. Any questions?
I just want to mention, since it came up during the public be heard, that as of June, the board had voted unanimously that the minimum wage at the library would be $15 an hour.
Yes.
And that will be effective June 1st.
Yes.
So, wanted to mention that. So we will see that later in the June budget report.
I make a motion to accept the budget versus actual.
I second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? The motion passes. General funds?
We look at general funds. Then we have $720,000 in the operating fund account, Bank of Green County. We still have some remainder funds at the TD Bank. I am waiting. There's one more retirement that they have been slow on changing. So that's still coming out from there. And as soon as that's done, we'll be closing the rest of the TD Bank. We got the tax check, so the above the money we have in the bank above that is from last year's underspending and a little bit from the previous year's underspending. Those are things that I discussed at other board meetings. We discussed last year pretty much at every meeting that we were underspending on personnel because of not having a staff person due to civil service complications. And last year in January at the meeting, I had said we would be putting reserve funds into the other funds in February, and then my life took a very serious, challenging turn. So that did not happen. And it did not happen when I came back in May because it was a struggle. And then in June, our library was under threat of dissolution and termination, and it didn't happen. And then I got to have another back surgery in September. So it just didn't happen last year, and it's not the way that I would normally put public funds, but that's what happened last year. So I take responsibility for that, but we do have money in the bank. Otherwise, this is all normal. We have some prepaid insurance and expenditures. Questions?
No? Okay.
I make a motion to accept the general funds report.
I second. All in favor?
Aye.
The last one actually still said general fund, but was the capital fund, which has the $9,454 in it.
Okay. And
changed
so,
since last month.
All right, now I believe some money is being transferred into capital funds. We're going to do that.
That's the operating, the general funds being.
Right.
We'll do that. We'll vote on that tonight.
Yeah. Okay, we're going to vote on that tonight. Yeah. Okay. Okay, good. Okay, thank you. Thank you, Jessica.
On capital funds.
Oh. I move we accept the capital funds report.
I second.
Okay, Carol.
This is the general fund report. Is that
what?
Different from the capital fund? Yeah.
Yes. Now, she crossed out. It was a typo. The last page is capital funds. And it's with some amount over $9,000.
That's my favorite.
But there will be a motion later this evening to transfer some more funds. Okay, so I moved and Carol seconded. All in favor of accepting the capital funds report?
Aye.
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 Okay. Opposed?
Did we accept the general funds report?
Yes, we did. Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Okay. All right. So now the director's report.
Yep.
And Jessica has some.
I'm working on a project that I'm really excited to share with everybody. And Bob, I'm going to stand over here, so you're either going to see my back or not. Thank you. Sorry.
Just grab the chair. Do you need your chair?
No. The project I've been working on has been a return on investment for the library, for the taxpayers, because I feel like over the last year, I have noticed that people say, we love the library, we love it. But I feel as though there's been a serious undervaluing of the library and what it does in our community. And so I set myself a task, and it was basically a logic problem of, you know, how can we figure this out? And I based my project on the Ottawa Public Library did a community benefit study a few number of years ago, which was really effective and informative for them. And they have an operating budget of $51.319 million. So that project was probably carried out by a financial team or consulting firm. This was done by me with an Excel sheet, the information from our state, our annual report to the state, value calculator, and help from our friendly bookkeepers and my professional experience. So I'm not saying that this is the be-all and end-all of everything, but it's a start to a conversation. The Woodstock Library provides a lot of value to our community. I don't know how to put a value on a grandmother printing out pictures of their new grandbaby that was born in Japan and they aren't going to visit here and for another year. I don't know how to put a value on friendships that are made in book club and in the knitting circle. I don't know how to put a value on getting tech assistance for a job search and uploading the resume
because that's the only way they're accepted now. And they're now happily employed. I don't know how to put a value on the kind words and caring that might possibly come to an old man that is going to go home alone, to his house alone. That those are the only words he gets all day that might be for him. I don't know how to put a value on the summer spent volunteering here that a young man did through high school and college, and then went off to get a high-paying engineering job that requires a security clearance. I know this because I helped with those forms, and I filled out a statement, and I talked to somebody in Washington. I don't know how to put a value on kids playing upstairs and learning to interact with each other while their parents watch them learn and grow. I don't know how to put a value on a young person's curiosity so they can come in here and look at everything they want to look at, whether that be triceratopses, weather patterns, princesses. I don't know how to put a value on the young man who first started coming here when he was 13 and was rambunctious and all over the walls, but settled down and began taking out probably 20 books a week. He graduated high school, got scholarships, went to college, and last summer he spent it in New York City doing a study on fish bacteria, and he was excited about it. I don't know how to put a value on medical information when you got a scary diagnosis. I don't know how to put a value on getting the latest cookbook for that fad diet or fancy. I don't know how to put values on things like that. I don't know how to put a value on the technology help that we give for somebody who doesn't have the money to go down the geek squad or have a helpful grandchild or nephew. I'm not qualified. And I don't know what the value is of a kid coming in and typing up their school report and printing it and taking it to school. But those are all things that have happened right here in this library. Those are things that I have experienced. Those things are important. They matter. And I know they matter because people come to me and they say, when I'm in the grocery store, when I'm in the apothecary, when I'm walking down the street, they say, oh my goodness, I was at the library and whatever happened. But they stop me wherever I am and they want to tell me about it. And they want to tell me how wonderful my staff is. I know it means something to people. I know it matters. And sometimes the library is the only chance that the person has of getting a helping hand, of getting a leg up, of getting whatever they need done, because we don't all have the support system that maybe you or I might enjoy to be here tonight instead of working. I think we can all agree that they do have value. And more, maybe more than the dollar amount can attest to. I think we can put a value on things that are more easily counted. What is the value of a book to check out? I know that you could quibble about every single number I've come up with. We could argue about it till we're blue in the face. I don't think that's productive or necessary. As I said, I set myself this logical problem and I worked through it. I wasn't expecting what I found. I wasn't expecting the numbers to be so high. And they are. I've discovered that every dollar provided to the library comes here and it grows. It grows into opportunities and opportunities for our community members. So while a value of $4.2 million might seem large for the services rendered to Woodstock in 2018, I don't think it is, and I think that that is just the starting point of a conversation because you can't add up all the things, the stories that I just told you. So the number that I came up with is a minimum. What I've been hearing from our community is that it's getting harder to live here, that it's not easy to afford rent, it's not easy to find a place to live, it's not easy to stay in your house because the taxes are going up, and I understand that. I've been hearing that from our public outreach. I've been hearing it in the library. I've been hearing it at Woodstock Town Comprehensive Plan meetings.
presentations and in the comprehensive plan. But I have also heard that a patron started using our digital magazines, and so she could cancel some subscriptions, and she's saving $200 a year. I know that I've heard that somebody came to our Qigong and they started a practice that they could never have afforded. I know that when I got an email, which the only thing it was a picture of somebody's diploma, that he started college or started his degree in Chicago and had to leave and had to move away, but he could finish it through our library with our services. He got his master's. And this is the warm and fuzzy stuff, but it means something. And maybe if you yourself haven't felt the strain, you haven't had to wonder if you can afford the food for your family, if you haven't had to cut your cable bill, cut your cell service, or go to the table at Woodstock, like hundreds of Woodstockers do, if you haven't had to decide between paying the heat and the electric, then maybe you were not listening. Because what I hear from our community is it's hard. And what I see here is that this is a place that people can make a better chance. People can have an opportunity. Any publicly traded company having a return on investment of 612% would be amazing. But we're already lucky because we already have that. We have it already here in this library. And I want our library to be valued for what it does in our community. And I think everyone in our community could find something they could spend $640 or $712 on right now. So what we have, the front part is the summary. That's everything that I came up with. If you want to go through it, I'm sorry this one is a little small. That I base this on our annual report to the state. So these are statistics that we have already submitted. These are activities that have already happened. This is value that's already happened in our community. I compared 2017 and 2018 with this. And I'd be happy to go through it if you want, or answer questions, or anything like that. I don't know if I want to go through it line by line, but I will. Any questions?
So basically, in 2018, people were getting $5.95 for every dollar.
For every tax dollar that came to the library. Okay. Woodstockers received $5.95 in services.
And then the values from the library value calculator of the New York Library Association, what did they add into that? The other spending in Ulster County and
so
Hudson?
This part is just services. And as I say, I was looking at the Ottawa report, and they had all of these statistics plus a whole lot more. They went into what their staff salaries did, and I didn't. So I think this number is not a whole picture, but it's more beyond. It's beyond, more than that's a little beyond me.
Well, but what I find really interesting is the bottom line on the first page, where it says, "For each hour we are open annually, the community is getting a per hour value of $1,886."
I wasn't expecting that when I started this project.
Yeah, 2018.
I wasn't. I was hoping for a return on investment. They say between $3 and I've seen up to as high as $14 for library services. So this is not the only study that's been done, nor is the other one. Libraries produce value in the communities.
And are worth investing in.
So when you look at And if you even entertain the possibility that $4.2 million worth of services happened in our community last year, how can we not invest in this library? How can we not make it the best thing possible?
I mean, I think you stated it very eloquently and beautifully, and I think that I will study this, and I will, for me myself, I will come back to you with any questions, but I get it.
I hope you'll give that report to every person who's had it.
Yes.
Yeah, I think I'll get some help from Nick, maybe. But I can, if anybody wants to, I can do a session, and anybody and everybody who comes and wants to, I will sit down with you and I will go through this line by line. I even went through and changed all the values of everything that we do here to $3 a piece, and it still came up with a 50% return on investment. And I think that's way too small of the valuation of everything we do here.
I'd just like to say that I really appreciate the, you know, quantifying this the way you did. But even more valuable is you telling us about all the things that are qualitative and cannot really be reduced to numbers.
None of that
doubles, I mean, everything you see here. So
yeah, none of the warm fuzzies are in this numbers.
Yeah, but I also really appreciate all the hours of work that went into putting this together and getting all the figures that back up this front page so that...
Especially because we are having so many conversations about figures right now. And,
yeah.
And so, to, yeah, this is looking at it as the investment that it is. It's helpful.
And I assume, and Kevin, can you use some of this in the conversations of the community?
Sure we can. Will this be posted?
Yeah.
Yeah. And now that this is a template in place, will it be easier on a go forward, or is it still going to be intensive?
Oh, absolutely. And I even, I've shared a little bit with Mid-Hudson, and I'm prepared to share with the New York Library Association, because if you added up every single library in the state, I think that would be astronomical and astounding.
Mm. It would help in advocating and learning.
Yeah,
that's great. Okay, so this will be posted on the website, and also your narrative as well?
Yes, which I have paper copies of.
There's paper copies of the qualitative report if anyone wants it.
Yes.
So thank you. That's being a great library director. Can do that. Thank you. Okay, now we get on to our committee reports. And you said you want a policy to go up first?
Yes.
And then I'm wondering if we should change the order after policy and go to fundraising and development, since we have people waiting here to hear that discussion in deference to our public. Yeah. Okay, policy and then development.
When we met this month, we developed three new policies and we made additions to two policies. All the board members got them in the mail, so as an email. I don't know if we have to sit and read them, but I'll tell you what they are. We came up with a capital fund policy. We came up with a personal benefits fund policy. A technology fund policy. And then we did a few separate lines as additions to our committee policies, finance committee, and a weeding policy addition. So does anybody have any questions?
Are we voting on this?
Yes, I'd like to make a motion to accept the three policies and the two additions to our policy manual.
I definitely have some questions about at least one of them.
Yes?
The weeding policy, I would think, would be the purview of the librarian. It's not a board issue. It's a day-to-day library issue.
The weeding policy is a policy recommended by Mid-Hudson, and a weeding policy is absolutely important for a library.
Of course.
Because it denotes how we're going to do things. All of our policies have to be voted on by the board. This addition is to help us make sure we're disposing of things properly.
So can I just follow up on that? I mean, what you're, this isn't very general. It's not saying what exactly is
No, this is this is the there is a weeding policy. This is an addition to it. Okay.
Right, these five lines are an addition to the weeding policy.
Is it written here? Anyway, I'd love for us to vote on it next week because I don't think I can read it over, understand it, and vote on it tonight. I mean,
you're just talking about the weeding policy, or
where
at least
is it?
That.
Where I'd like to have a copy of it too.
They were all sent
to
us.
Board
packet.
Yeah. Oh, sorry.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Well,
the full policy.
The full policy.
The full policy. All the full policies are in the policy manual on the website. Every board member should be responsible for reading all the policies
and
knowing
as I have, but this was
and knowing the meaning of them and what they refer to. So this is just a simple addition, and if you want to read these five lines and if you like them, you can vote for it with us.
As I said, I'd rather have a chance to ponder the consequences of voting for them, even if I understand them. I think they're things to think about. That's where I stand.
As far as policies are concerned, if I'm not mistaken, you have to sit on them for 30 days after you're given the opportunity to look at a change, and then you vote on them. I'm not accurately sure, but I'm pretty sure. I think that we should sit on these for 30 days and then decide.
I don't think there's anything in our bylaws that state that necessity, but if the board just decides that, that's just fine.
For myself, totally no disrespect. I didn't do due diligence and study these before I came, so I'm uncomfortable with, and I don't think I can grab it all in 5 minutes.
Yeah.
I'm saying that's my call.
Right, so let me put it this way. Mm-hmm. I was going to ask every board member if you're going to be here next month, because next month we're going to vote on the bylaws,
mm-hmm.
which is going to be 11 pages. So you're going to be giving yourself double duty homework by reading these and then reading the bylaws for the next meeting. Does everybody agree to that?
I'm comfortable with that.
Is everybody comfortable with that?
Depends
yes.
on when we get the bylaws.
Right.
We
the
got
bylaws.
This
well,
yesterday.
Not yet, but we are about to. The reason that we need everyone to be at the meeting is because our current bylaws state that every trustee must vote to change them.
Right.
Okay.
Well,
we can do that. I'm sorry. Yeah.
I mean, somebody could be absent for a policy mm-hmm. as long as we have a minion, but... But we have to vote on these eventually and soon.
And
we'd like to
if
get
we're
in
all
place.
Here, that's my hope with creating the fund policies was that we could move funds into them so
right.
that I feel like we're being more responsible to our taxpayers. As I described, last year that was the intent in the beginning of the year.
So we want to make a motion to table this for next month.
Along with the overall bylaws.
And the bylaws will be sent out. It has to be sent out 10 days prior
no,
to
no,
the
no.
meeting.
I would like to send them to the trustees sooner. I would like
yes.
to post them sooner. What is required is legal notice in the paper
right.
of at least 10 days.
10 days.
But
is that 10 business days?
It doesn't say that.
Okay, so I make a motion to table the new policies for next month's meeting.
I'll second it.
All in favor?
All in favor?
Aye.
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 Aye. Opposed?
The motion passes. Thank you. Okay. I just want to, we're going to go now to the Development and Fundraising Committee, which is kind of combined. The build, we have a special Build a Better Library Committee also, which is made up of Chair of Communication, Development, Finance, Planning, and the Vice President, and the Building Committee Chair. And we ended up having kind of a, the Fundraising Committee meeting bled over into the Build a Better Library Committee meeting, because it was in the wake of the fundraising training we had had with the head of the Mid-Hudson Library System, who raised the issue of, you know, doing all bonding versus all private fundraising or doing a hybrid as we were planned. I just wanted, before we the board discusses it, I apologize, I forgot to read for public be heard. William Eady had sent me something, and in interest of time, I'm going to kind of summarize it, and I can email it to all the trustees. But basically, he said to consider initiating a bond measure prior to initiating a private capital fundraising campaign, just putting the cart before the horse. Just because you have authority to do the thing does not mean that you should do it. And he said, at this stage in the process, the first goal should be to gain the support of the community for building a new library, rather than supporting any particular version. And the second goal should be to build community excitement and create buzz for financing the new library. And he said the first goal would be achieved by engaging the community in discussion, which the board has promised to do. And Will is on the group with Kevin Kraft and Susan Nicholson that is preparing, and that's going to start sometime in April.
Correct.
The conversations with the community, which will be happening all over town and in several organizations. And he said, his personal opinion is the trustees have not received a mandate from the community to issue a bond prior to initiating a private capital fundraising campaign. Rather, the board's mandate and its publicly voiced intention is to engage the community in a discussion as to why building new is preferable to any kind of renovation plus addition scenario. And I believe to think otherwise is wishful thinking. So, and then he said, in the event that you decide to bond first, what happens if the bond should fail? Haven't you just sent the message that the community voters should not believe in a new library enough to even vote for the bond? And he said, haven't you just hamstrung any subsequent private capital fundraising campaign before it even gets started? Because, you know, so anyway, so he believes it's the cart before the horse to bond first. So I can email, if people want his complete statement, that's pretty much it. And that was from Public Beaver. Okay. So Selma, do you want to...
I can. It would be easier if you did. Just, okay. It's all... Everybody
okay,
has
I'll
a copy of it.
Okay.
I think.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah, everyone... it's on the... basically, the Fundraising and Development and Build a Better Library Committee, when we met, it was Jill Fisher, Kevin Kraft, Dorothea, Liz Rosen, Selma Kaplan, Barry Miller, and David Lewis. And Will Eady, Hannah Abraham, and John Ludwig were observing. We discussed, the committee discussed the presentation by Rebecca Smith Aldridge regarding the mounting of a capital campaign to support the new Woodstock Library Building Project. And we called her RSA, like RBG. RSA encouraged us to choose a path, either bonding or a capital campaign, and stick with it. We discussed the necessity of thorough planning and the traditional model of capital campaigns, whereby 70% of the funding is obtained quietly before a public launch for more like small-scale donations. And we spoke about crowdfunding and special events. We discussed the pros and cons of three different models. The first is to bond for the full amount of building and conducting a capital campaign after the bond passed to pay for ancillary expenses not covered by the bond, like furnishings and bells and whistles and other things that would not be included in the $5 million. The advantages of this approach would be the process, if successful, would be much faster, and there will be money in the bank to support matching grants, like the State Construction Authority. As a special district library, we're in a unique position to bond, which association libraries are not. Other special districts have had successful bond votes. Potential donors would be assured that the project will really come to fruition.
We can maintain the momentum generated by the successful defeat of the referendum, which cemented our special district status. The cons, the arguments against bonding for the full amount, are will the community support a bond for the entire amount? If not, would a capital campaign be successful? Why would individual donors contribute to a project that doesn't have community support? We have said publicly that we would raise money to offset the cost of the bond. And then the second option is raising the entire amount through donations and grants. Pros, we are Woodstock, therefore we don't have to do things the traditional way. There's a lot of community support for the library. There's a great deal of money in the community, and the Woodstock brand could draw donors from outside the area. For example, we thought of, with the 50th anniversary, you know, doing something on Facebook for everyone who attended the concert to donate $50 to the Woodstock Library. You never know. There will be many naming opportunities, and other local libraries have had successful, if lengthy, capital campaigns. When you do it all private fundraising, it can take several years. The cons against this are nobody on the board has the skills required to mount and manage a capital campaign, and we would have to hire someone to at least train us and help us plan. Any money raised would have to be returned to donors if the capital campaign was not successful. The process could take a long time, although we don't know that for sure. The longer it takes, the more the project will cost. And then number three is the hybrid approach, which we had already, you know, publicly endorsed, which is using both bonding and a capital campaign. Pro, this is what we publicly said we would do. We can keep people in the loop. This was a great idea someone had, by using dual thermometers. So you'd have two thermometers outside the library. And as the capital campaign raised money, as that thermometer went up, the amount for the bond would go down. So, you know, you'd see this kind of, you know, visual thing that the more money that people donate, then the less we'd have to bond for the taxpayers. The cons, Rebecca Smith Aldrich, who has worked at Manhattan Library Association for 20 years and said that she has, I think, been involved, seen 30 new libraries built or added on to. She thinks this is the riskiest way to go. She advised us against it. She favored choosing one plan and sticking with it, and we would still need to hire a campaign coordinator. Immediate actions required. We want to have a full board discussion on the fundraising options, which we're going to begin tonight. Obtaining a schematic design, which will be necessary for any case statement, regardless of which path we choose. Raising the $500,000 required for architectural services, which we would need to do, depending when the contract is signed, we would need to do that by early 2020. It may not be January, it might be a month or two later, depending when the clock starts on the contract. To raise this money, Rebecca Smith Aldrich recommended forming an ad hoc committee under the auspices of the Friends as fiscal sponsor. This committee, separate from the board and comprised of friends and allies, would undertake the initial fundraising required to obtain the schematic designs. We have the money already for the schematic designs in our budget, so it would be to obtain the rest of the funding for the architect. The $500,000. We would have a memo of understanding with them, not unlike the one we have with the Friends now. And we have, our lawyer has said that, you know, it's very simple to do that kind of memorandum. Other special district libraries have done that. And any money raised either could be held by the Friends or by the Community Foundation of Ulster County. And we did at the, and Tammy, were you at the Friends meeting Tuesday night?
Yes.
Okay. And I understand that the Friends said they were fine with mm-hmm. with being the overseeing organization for the Capital Committee. And one of the things about a Capital Campaign Committee is the Friends are not a government agency. They're a 501c3 nonprofit. So it's not subject to the open meetings law. So people could have conversations in the Capital Campaign Committee about specific donors and strategies that would not be, you know,
publicly exposed. So that's the report from Building Better Library and Development, and I open the floor for people. I know a lot of you have been thinking about this in the last few weeks. It's a really tough, it's a real tough one. It's a very difficult decision, and you know, but I'm curious how people are thinking about it right now. We're not going to vote on anything tonight. You know, what we are, I think, going to vote on is setting up this capital campaign committee, subject to getting the memorandum of understanding
if
from the...
If people want to.
Yeah. I would recommend that we vote to form a committee using whatever language the memorandum of understanding is recommended by our council. You know. Okay. Yes. Yeah.
Oh, no, I was just going to ask about that, that what you just said, we're going to vote tonight on what?
Well, we can decide that after we talk. We could decide to endorse the concept of forming a capital campaign committee under the auspices of the Friends without having the specific language for the MOU tonight. But so rather than waiting for the April board meeting.
And that committee would put the strategy together.
Yes.
So.
But based on the... Obviously, the feelings of the board, they would put together a strategy and a timetable.
Right. So personally, I feel more comfortable having a strategy in place before we move forward on any decisions. Signing anything or moving, just...
I'm talking about signing the contract. And...
Yeah, I feel like if we can put a plan in place and look at it and see it, this is just my personal mindset, then I have a sense and a confidence that we have a plan to move forward. Mm-hmm. Right now I feel like there isn't a fundraising plan to be confident in. Mm-hmm. So I would be very happy to vote for a committee and gaining a strategy that we can work with. And that once that vision is set, then I think we can step backwards and figure out what the timeline is. I don't think we have a realistic sense of that just now. Or I don't. I'll speak for myself. Mm-hmm.
Bobby,
who's on that committee? Who would be on that committee?
Well, you know, Friends of the Library could be on it, Allies of the Library. I don't know if any trustees can be on it.
I believe so.
Trustees
can be on it. Yes.
That's what...
Yeah, it's such a bombshell. It was like that was a very big bit of news, and it really sort of turned us all upside down in terms of how we've been conceiving of the whole thing. And it is such it's a very critical matter. So I agree with having a plan in place to help guide us.
I endorse Kevin's idea. I would go a little further, because after all, once you have a plan, you can do some sanity checking. For example, if you say we're going to do this in 3 months and everybody else has taken 5 years, you really have to answer the question, how am I to expect that I can do it 20 times faster than they? Or even if you say I can do it in 1 year, and other people have taken many years, how can you expect to convince anyone that we're so different that we can do it faster than they are? And there are other examples. Also, it's an opportunity to get everything down on paper so that questions are asked, we have the answers, and that we understand the consequences of our own actions. So I think Kevin is exactly right. We have to be careful here.
One thing I think, I don't know, it was Kevin or someone had suggested, was that maybe we have as a goal to raise the $500,000 that we need for the architect's fee that we'll need by early next year, you know, to spend this year doing that, you know, getting the schematic designs, having our case statement. And then once we raise the money so that we have the architect's fee covered, we could then, we'll have a better idea from the community conversations and the initial fundraising, how viable our goal of raising $2 or $3 million is, you know, privately, or whether, you know, we need to bond for a larger amount. We could decide the bonding question next year, or whenever we get, maybe we'll have the $500,000 earlier, you know, but, you know, to start off with like a chunk of it, you know, that would ensure the project going forward before deciding on the bonding versus private fundraising.
And I guess that discussion will be had in detail by the fundraising committee.
Right, the capital committee, yes.
But I must say, I do like the idea to an extent of getting, raising the money for the architect and getting better cost estimates than we really have now. Mm-hmm. I mean, people come up with various figures and mm-hmm. we really don't have a solid mm-hmm. basis. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think before, you know, it'll help us in fundraising too, if we can say it's going to be X amount for this and X, you know, yeah. X amount for that. Go through John's list,
yeah.
Come up with figures. I think that's all very important to do.
Yeah, I think John's list can't really be answered until we go through a process with the architect.
Yeah.
So I and think some of the yeah.
That's really, I would not like to vote or donate till I knew
Selma or Jill or Tammy, Bobby and Barry.
I agree with what Kevin is bringing up. I think we should have a strategy planned out before we move forward.
Mm-hmm. I would endorse that as well.
Good, would. As would Selma?
Would you?
Bobby?
Yep.
Jill?
I agree.
Yeah, that makes all the sense in the world. I've been working on that strategy for 2 years, and I've actually written it out. But I think it's very interesting to say we're going to hold off on signing any kind of contract with Tilly until we somehow form this committee, get the MOU in place. We started our conversations with Tilly and with the lawyer in January 4th, and now we're almost at the end of March. And if we just keep, I mean, how fast can we get this committee together? People are talking now about hiring help, you know, so... These are two things that kind of go hand in hand, and just to let people know, one of the things in that we've really been working on with the contract with Tilly is to break it into sections, very clear stages where we wouldn't go on to spend more than what we've already said we would. So I think $75,000 we approved at our last meeting, and that could be done initially. But the clock does start ticking, and we're working on getting a little more flexibility in that whole time frame. So, yeah, I mean, I'd like to get going with that plan.
And my biggest concern is that tick tock of the 30 months.
I think we may have a little more flexibility than that.
Right.
Yeah, we might be able to kind of pause it at a certain point.
Yeah.
We're
working on that language.
Yeah. Great.
That would be great.
But I'd like to know by next.
A lot of the public is here, I do want people to know that the $75,000 to pay for the schematic designs is we have that money on hand. We have money in the capital fund and some of it in the capital fund. We have some money from the Friends and we have some surplus from last year which is going to be transferred into the capital fund.
Now this is to pay for?
For the $75,000 for the schematic designs. So we do have that money on hand without doing any fundraising.
And those schematics will give us...
That will give us
a better...
We have the
cost
model.
Estimates along with the model. Is that right?
Well, it'll have like a very specific... Like we won't just have like the model there. You'd have renderings, right? We'll let you in for sure.
That schematic plan then reduces what the model and the renderings that were done as a part of the design competition were based on 15,000 gross square feet. we've already told the architect that, no, we're going to reduce that to 12,000 per square feet in order to make sure we come within the setback requirements and we increase parking. So, and we will get better refinement of the cost, but it's not going to be, you know, definitive at that point. It'll be a better handle on it so that we know what we need to raise and,
you know, but you could bring
whatever
that to
way we decide.
You could bring that to donors, what I'm saying.
Right. That will give you more confidence. But much of what we have now, we could be taking to.
That's what I'm wondering. I mean,
we have a beautiful model, and we can say, oh, yeah, we'll be shrunk down a little bit. Mm-hmm. We have the concept design that could be, you know, printed up. We could make our case statement. So we could get started with some level of fundraising right away.
Okay.
We don't have to wait till we have the schematic designs.
That's good.
But these kinds of questions that John lists would be better, you know, addressed once we have schematics.
Yeah. And also when John was going through them, when he suggested with the hourly rate for a construction manager, that, you know, we can't assume that would be, you know, we're assuming a monthly amount, but, you know, we don't know.
There was a lot of assumptions.
Yeah, there's an assumption that would be a certain amount, which usually someone paid hourly is billing hourly, not on a salary. So,
right.
But I would think we could form this committee next week. I mean,
within the next couple of seven.
Yeah, I mean, you know, and I think we're getting, if we can legally pass a motion that supports the establishment of this committee, subject to the legal language we will get from our attorney, who we trust.
Well, that will then be voted on.
That would be voted on at the next meeting, that the committee could start meeting before then.
Right.
I mean, I was just trying to avoid having to have a special board meeting. But
can I ask something?
Sure.
If this board votes to establish this capital campaign committee, mm-hmm. does it not then become ours? Can't our supporters go ahead and do that without our voting? Because I'm concerned that some kind of legal thing comes into play if we
I think what we'd be voting for is to develop a memo of understanding with our with
friends.
The community or
no,
with the capital committee. We already have a memo of understanding with the friends. We need to have a memo of understanding with
regarding the capital project
to be
drafted
by our lawyer with the friends as our fiscal sponsor.
Right.
Yes.
Is that right?
Yes.
Who wants to make that? The motion.
Mm-hmm. And I guess the memo of understanding should lay out what they're raising the money.
Yes, oh absolutely.
For example, is it specific? Is it to raise money to do something with Tilly as architecture, as architect? Mm-hmm. Could the money be used for an alteration of the vision? I mean, the question, I think we have to be very specific so that the people who give the money know exactly what they're giving it for.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, goodness. Okay. One thing that was brought up tonight a bit in the public we heard is that people have different opinions in our community. And I think that there's been multiple interpretations of the purpose of the referendum and what the votes mean, and that probably there's about 70 different meanings in our community of what happened and what it means. And I would like there to be a part of our plan that addresses that. Our community.
I think the community conversations can help with that.
I think part of the purpose of the community conversations is to in, engage with the community, the decision-making process the board has gone through, based on experts, facts, and that information, and then allowing a feedback opportunity for the community to go back to the Build a Better Library Committee.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So those mechanisms are there, and I saw an email from Susan that explained that she's now back from a journey and can commit to finishing writing her portion of the program, but then will step away from the project because of the stress involved.
For
her,
she will.
For her personally,
But I mean, but she completes her part of it.
She'll complete her part with Will, and then I'll probably sit down and finish it with some feedback, and then I expect to be done by the end of the, So we'll take it back in house, so to speak.
Bye, Lauren, thank you. Our liaison is leaving. Okay, good.
Can I just put this in minutes? I just want to make sure I've got this right. The trustees agreed to ask our attorney to draw up a memo of understanding to establish a capital committee under the auspices of the Friends as fiscal sponsor?
Yes.
Is that
a
fair?
Yes. Well, do we need to vote on that?
I don't think so.
I think we're just
we're just agreeing that we're going to ask the lawyer.
This is not
our act.
But is Jill, do people agree with Jill that individuals who want to help us raise money could start meeting?
As soon as we have a case statement.
I think there needs to be a place to park it, though. That's the only thing.
Yeah, we need to. That's the other thing. We need to talk to the Community Foundation about setting up a place to park
the money.
Yeah.
So the question is, though, before we have the memorandum of understanding, if we get it in the next few days, would you like to have a special board meeting to approve it? Or do we want people to start doing stuff informally, and we deal with that at the April 19th board?
Well, we've already started doing some stuff.
Yeah. Okay.
We can vote on it in April.
Okay.
So at this point, if they start doing it and it goes to the Friends as our fiscal sponsor to hold, I think that's that's fine.
Yeah.
And then once we have the MOU, we can talk to the Community Foundation and set up
a
different place to park it. But I mean, if I walked in tomorrow and said, I want to give you $100,000, you should take it.
Well,
I would.
The MOU, like all
thank
the
you,
other
Liz.
Policies. The MOU, like all the other policies.
Did you get that, Nick?
The MOU, like all the other policies, will have to be read by everybody by the next meeting.
We can make sure it goes out with your policies and then.
Well, the policies for today are out there.
Right.
You just have to read them.
It just wasn't a special email.
And we'll make sure you get the bylaws.
Okay. All right. So we're not making any decision tonight on the bonding versus private fundraising.
I just want to look to see if any other questions that were brought up at public be heard could be addressed. We've got John's
numbers. Oh, well, Janice had asked about whether the public is on the hook for the $500,000.
Right, which is not true.
And even the trustees are not on the hook for it.
And we did already state that we raised everybody.
Yes, we raised the minimum wage beginning June 1st is $15.
And we're
actually
proud
now we get to my
people do not know that.
To my committee report, we have to
make
a motion.
can we move now to Liz's report, because we're getting close to 9 o'clock? So Liz.
Okay. Last month we voted.
This is the finance.
We voted to raise the minimum wage that we are paying our staff, our part-time staff, to $15 an hour. So we have. have a couple of
the only
I was the one who made the motion.
Yeah.
There was a second and we voted on it.
Yeah.
Okay.
We already voted on it and passed it.
No,
we passed that, but I'm looking for, I don't have the motion here for moving the...
It is in there, it's on the last page.
The last page.
Number one, right?
Okay. That's the office equipment and bookkeeping. These are other...
Here, this is right here.
$20,000.
But we can't do...
We can't do these because we didn't approve the funds. Budget amendment to change chart of accounts.
This one. Because we have that.
Okay.
And we do have the...
Right, but...
We can do that one.
Well, wait, let me, I may have it here in my notes. Because we have to make a budget adjustment. If I find the right piece of paper.
That's why you were talking about the raise.
The raise, yes. We have to...
Move the funds.
We have to move some funds into...
They're right here. Do you have...
Yeah.
Move $5,000 out of 74.4 and other expenses combined.
That's it.
That's a different matter than...
That's a different matter that we also have to agree to.
Is it, I mean, there's that, that already happened, we just need to fix the typo, and then there's the...
I just gotta have two budget things, so it makes it a little confusing. That's the budget versus actual, because we're moving, and I forget how much we're moving.
It's on the...
From retirement and from...
We already did that. Those were approved. What we approved was incorrectly a typo that we should have... We voted to move 5,000 from fund balance, but that's not what's in there. It should have been 5,000 from contingency, so we didn't move any of it.
And that's to pay for the raises.
Yes. And we have, as we've said, additional contingency funds from last year.
Well, I'm going to assume that we did what we had to for that to cover the raises.
Yeah.
So why do we need...
Well, we do need to correct the... Can you please make a budget adjustment on moving 5,000 from 74.474 contingency to...
Yeah.
Salaries.
To personnel
right.
costs.
I moved
to personnel costs.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
You already voted on that, but that's just changing
the... Just changing the fund. Okay. And on the next thing, the only thing we can vote on, because we have a capital fund, is that we are voting to move $100,000 from our last year's surplus to the capital fund.
Okay.
And
we can do that.
We can do that.
I'll make the motion.
And okay. What is the merit of doing that?
We need the money for the schematic design.
No,
the idea is that we're moving some of the overage from last year to the capital fund so that we can spend it on the schematic design.
No.
We're putting it in the capital fund rather than leaving it as a big overage in our retained earnings. That's
the responsible thing to do with monies that are above unspent in our budget is to put them in a reserve fund.
But we're doing it specifically in the capital fund.
Well, we're doing part of it in the
not
capital
all
fund.
No.
We are establishing a couple of other funds that we're not voting on this.
Okay.
at this meeting, and we will put money in those too.
So it's all going in the capital fund?
No, no, no.
For the moment?
Only $100,000.
Oh, yeah, yes.
And I made the motion.
Yes.
Right.
And the money.
Okay, the motion is on the table to move $100,000 from the surplus.
And I second it.
To the capital fund. Okay, the seconds, any discussion or questions? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
And then just some housekeeping. To change, we have to vote to change the chart of accounts to match the changes in categories on our annual report to Albany. So I don't know that we need to read through all of it unless you want. It's just changing account numbers. The total of other expenses will remain the same. So I move that we vote to approve these changes to make our chart of accounts in accordance with the categories.
I second. Okay. Any discussion? Seems clear here. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Okay, thank you. Thank you, Finance.
Thank you,
Budget. And what's your new title? You're no longer treasurer, you're...
Fiscal officer.
Fiscal officer.
Okay.
Oh,
fiscal officer. Okay. All right. We still have building and communication.
That's true.
And friends. Let's let Tammy go first. She always ends up last. Let's keep Tammy.
Well, thank you. One thank
friends
you.
Liaison.
They did speak about the memorandum, and they were quite positive about it. And
this is the friend.
They're a wonderful group of people. They have committed $650 a month on a regular basis, on a monthly basis, directly for children's programming. They're still picking up all the other programs that they endorse. But I thought that was important for
and
us.
And this is the Friends of the Library she's telling me about.
I thought it was important for us to see that they're giving us $650 a month. And the way that you illustrated your figures, I look at that $650 and I think about paperback books for 25 cents or a dollar for hardcover. How many books do you have to sell for 25 cents and a dollar to make $650 a month for children's programming? It's astronomical, it really is. And their commitment to the library is just, I'm speechless, I really am. But I just wanted to bring that up. I thought that was important. And they are quite supportive and they're waiting for the next step.
Yeah. And the first book sale of the year will be this coming Saturday.
No, April
13th.
Oh, that's right, they can't get in the
just
phone
just trying to see if they're paying attention. April 13th isn't this weekend. Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much, Tammy. Okay, Kevin and Jill, who wants to go first?
Cool. Kevin, you go.
Kevin.
Communications. I already spoke a little bit about the Build a Better Library community outreach. So the other piece is just Aaron, Jessica, and Caroline continue to meet on our website and the redevelopment of that. So that's ongoing, so slow and steady.
I'm so excited.
Site mapping and content are the dish du jour now, right?
Mm-hmm.
And we have Jessica sent an alternative free software for community engagement, which is now being looked at, which will dovetail, I think, the opportunities when we go out to the community. And then marketing logo, ongoing, Caroline, and setting up a kind of a stylistic online file so that each board member will have access to PowerPoint presentations that we do, logos,
letterhead.
letterhead, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So that's coming soon. So that's it.
Thank you. Oh, and I guess next week is our
meeting.
Meeting.
Yes.
What, Thursday night, the 28th? Is it?
It's 7 o'clock, yes.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Kevin.
You're welcome.
And last but not least is Jill with the building committee.
Yeah, I'll keep it real short. We've already talked a little bit about the our main conversation was the discussing the contract with Tilly. The lawyer has recommended that we also engage a construction manager agent or slash advisor. So that contract has to dovetail with Tilly's. So we're working on all of that. You know, that's going to be going on for a while now. Heating issues, we had been getting cost estimates to add these, replace these air conditioning units with heating units. And we got 4 different contractors to give us prices. And then we are wondering whether we can just crank up the heat of them. And I think, you know, after some discussion, we said to Jessica, you go ahead, you make the decision whether or not you want to maybe replace one, because it wasn't going to be any more expensive to put one unit in this room than to come in and do them all at once. So, because we wanted to do one back in the children's area and one upstairs, heating and air conditioning. Right now, they're mostly air conditioning.
The what's in the walls is either not working or just air conditioning.
Yeah, they're not. Yeah, either that. And so,
it's keeping the heat at a more higher level, but not turning it down at night has been helping some. It doesn't help everything.
Not turning it all the way down, or turning it down just a little?
Just a little. Because, and it seems to be helping, but we're still working with the staff on that. Yeah.
And we're at the end of the season, so it may make sense to wait till the fall too. Mm-hmm. So we'll see how it goes.
Or do it in the middle of summer.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, there's AC.
Yeah.
If, I mean,
yeah.
If that's an issue,
AC
we do have
yeah.
a window okay. unit here.
Yeah.
So we
yeah.
do have AC. We had the Roto-Rooter guy come, and he couldn't get his little camera all the way through our drainage. So we're back to square one on that.
He just, like, how far could he get?
He could get about 30 feet, and then the camera cord just coils up. The water is still flowing through it.
This is the drainage in the front.
It goes
under
the lawn.
Didn't he see daylight? Didn't he see?
Yeah, he can see through it, so it's not like it's clogged. We discussed they could possibly come back and blow it the whole thing out, but I was concerned that it would damage the pipe further.
You have like a little child.
I don't know why. They should have a little RC truck that runs it through.
A dachshund.
It's
a
dog.
Or
that
we
need
dachshunds. Ferrets.
Now you're getting
silly. It's a pretty smart dog.
So anyway, the drainage is still an ongoing discussion. Okay.
Do they still charge the full amount?
No. They charge on an hourly basis, and it was a lot cheaper than what I thought it would be. Just let me note that tree work is going to happen on April 2nd, and we are going to take out one tree that's dead, but instead of totally taking it out, we're going to see if we can turn it into a chair in the middle of the lawn. Just cut it off that way so that we have one more seat out there. And we'll also get busy with our exterior hand railing that'll cost us $250 plus wages for Roger. And I know that Jessica reported that she has contracted with a different cleaning service for the interiors. they're coming at different times, and the result has been better upkeep and cleaner.
There were some stains in the upstairs carpet that are gone, which is pretty exciting.
And I also just want to mention something that came out at the meeting with the BBL committee, the Build a Better Library. Hannah Abraham complimented Jessica on clearing out the front computer area. She said, boy, yes, it made a world of difference for her. So I just wanted to pass that on. It's not really in my report.
Okay. Yeah. And also people were very happy with the new configuration in the art books room.
Yeah, staff are amazing, and then I think we've moved everything around just as much as we possibly can. And then
okay, great. All right, is there any, we've heard from all the committees. Planning, David Lewis isn't here tonight. It's now called the Plan of Service Committee. Jessica, do you want to read this report since you're at the meeting?
We discussed the Plan of Service and we're reviewing it for any additions or changes that need to be done in regards to capital projects, and there's not. We are working to evaluate the Town of Woodstock Comprehensive Plan and put in information from that into ours and show where the library answers needs of the community that the town has identified.
Yeah. Integrate into.
Yeah.
Okay. And I must say, if I was at that meeting, and I thought it was really excellent the way it had been identified how many of the community's goals can be forwarded by the library through its services. And it was really impressive. It kind of goes along with your return on investment report.
I didn't think it was important. I wouldn't work in libraries if I didn't think it was important.
All right. Any new business? Any old business first?
I'll make a motion to adjourn.
Wait. No, all right. Wait. Second. Any new business? Okay. The next regular meeting of the Board of Trustees will be Thursday, April 18th at 7 p.m.
We sent this out.
Yeah. Okay. And is there anyone else? We have a repeat public be heard if anyone wants to comment further. Leslie? Leslie Gerber?
I'm Leslie Gerber. You won't need to talk, but this is going to take me a minute. I keep hearing comments from opponents of this library about what the public has to decide in order to do things. I want to point out that we live in a representative democracy. The public has already made decisions on these matters. This board is democratically and legitimately elected and put in a position to serve the public by making the decisions that affect the library. The budget is voted on in a democratic and legitimate manner. The results indicate that the public wants the library to continue. The referendum, which was created by opponents of the library, was defeated by a large margin in a democratic and legitimate vote. I would like for the people of this community to recognize that this library board has the legitimate responsibility to make the decisions that it is making. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hey, I second that.
Thank you.
Thank you. Can I just answer something? Just say something in relation to that? I know Julie left, but she had made the remark about how board members are elected, people are elected to the board, that there was some kind of committee. I'm very new to Woodstock, less than 3 years. I came to the library, I walked in, I said, this is great, but it could be better. I didn't know anyone on the board. I saw that there was an opening. I ran for that short opening against Caroline, I lost. I ran again in the official election. I didn't know anyone. So who would vote for me? So it was fine, I ran again. There wasn't a special committee that, no one here approached me. I didn't know anyone. I'm still getting to know the town. I just want to correct that. And I want to say, if you want to get involved, next time when there's a seat, run. Run for the seat, get involved.
There's never a ball.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you. And I don't know, if anyone has Julie's email, they can send that to her.
I recognize the generous contribution you're making to the community and to the library by coming here regularly and discussing these matters. And I'm grateful to you for that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay.
I'll make a motion to adjourn.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay.
I'm redoing that.
I'm redoing.